they will start our second tutorial, and we'll be going to cover some important Python library, such as NumPy. And in the second step, we are going to go deep to PyTorch, and we are going to I will introduce you some of the most important PyTorch variables and containers. So first, let's give some brief reminder about NumPy. Actually, the whole code is on the Jupyter notebook, so you can actually run this code on your computers after our tutorial. Okay, and I will run the code in real time. So it's going to be fun. Okay, so NumPy. Actually, NumPy array is a container that optimized to do very fast calculations. Such as deviation, multiplying, adding and subtracting, actually, as we know, that in neural network we are doing computation between matrices, multiplying matrices. So it's very important to do this computational preprocessing in very fast way. So first. We will import our NumPy as from Python library. So we are doing NumPy import NumPy as np. Yeah, and here we actually see the definition of a one-dimensional array. Yeah, in x1 is actually one-dimensional array. Yeah, it's have some function of randomization and the size takes. The x2 is actually two-dimensional array. Yeah, we actually declare it in the brackets. Okay, his size will be 3/4. Yeah, and the x3 is actually three-dimensional array, have dimensions of 3, 4. Okay, so let's run it. Okay, so now we actually have our three variables, x1, x2, x3. Their type is actually nd array. Now we can ask which dimension our variables. So we are doing it here. So here we actually print that our dimension of x3 is 3, and his shaping is 3 by 4 by 5, and his size is 60. Okay, great. So another very important attribute of a NumPy array is dtype. Okay, so we are when we apply dtype on ng array, we got his type. So his type is actually is int 64. Okay, this way we can ask what's the type of our variable that are in our arrays. Okay? I mean the cell variable, the variables into the cells. Okay. So other attribute is item size. Okay? Actually, which lists the size in bytes of each array element in n bytes, which is the total size of the bytes of the array. Okay? So the first will give us item size, actually. 8 bytes, yeah? And the number of whole bytes is 400. Very good. Now, question? Okay. Now we talk about array indexes. Okay. So okay. So we have our x1 that we declared before. Array, yeah, have fixed elements and chosen randomly. Okay, and now we want to access to the first element. So we are going this way. Okay, so now we actually our what will be done? So the answer will be 5. Yeah. So the x1 in the place view is 5. Yeah. Great. So. It's magic. Okay, now x1 in place 4. So x1 in place 4 will be 7. Yeah. Okay, so it works. Very good. Now we can access our in the arrays. Yeah, and we can make some operation between them. Okay, so. If we want to do index from the end of the array, we can actually use negative indices. Okay, so x1 minus 1 in place minus 1, minus 1 is gonna be
9.
9. Yeah. Sure. And x1 in place minus 2 is gonna be 7. Okay. So x1 minus 2 is actually like x1. In place 4. Yeah. Okay. Is it clear?
Is it circular from minus infinity to plus infinity?
Yeah. It's not yeah, the from the array definition. Yeah. So, okay, so we have 9, here we have 7. Very good. Now, in multi-dimensional array, our items can be accessed using a comma-separated tuples of indices. Okay. So our x2, I remind you, is actually two-dimensional in the array. Yeah. Yeah, we have here two-dimensional in the array. So if we want to access to x1 in place 0, right, 0, 0, what will be the answer here? 3, yeah? Sure. So it's actually, if we have two-dimensional array, we have x and y, so it's actually the first indices, okay? Very good. So, and x2 in place 2, 0 will be 1. Yeah. 0 is 3, okay, and 1. Very good. Okay, so our values can be modified using any of the proof indices in notation. So if we actually modify our element in place 0, 0, so now our the whole array have changed. Okay, so it's actually straightforward. Okay, now we have our in the array is have. The first value is no. Okay? Great. Now we are going okay, so keep in mind that unlike Python list, numarray have a fixed type, okay? So for example, if we attempt to insert a floating point value to integer array, the value will be truncated. Okay? So actually, if all our types are floating point types or integer types, okay, if we want to apply the other types, it will casting or trunked to the original type of the array. Okay? Is it clear? So in our case, we want to apply x0 in place 0, x1, excuse me, in place 0 to, remember what it is?
Pi.
It's pi. It's not actually pi, yeah, it's pi, rounded pi, yeah? It's rounded pi, but it, it's accuracy, you know? It's okay. Okay, so, what happened here? It's truncated, yeah? It's rounded to the the nearest integer now. Okay? Clear. Very good. Okay. So now we will talk a little bit about iteration on empty arrays. So we can actually, okay, so first of all, we will start from size. So if you want to choose subarrays, yeah, define subarrays, we actually using slice character, this character, okay, and it means actually that we will choose the x values from start to stop, and this is will be our step. Okay, so if we don't define the third, third element, we actually only actually use the default value, and default value is 1. Yeah. So if we have array of 7 elements and we want to subarray of 5 elements, okay. So we actually define our subarray from one to 5. Yeah. And we actually have other copy of this subarray. Okay. It's separate variable. Great. So one-dimensional subarray, define some x, and we arrange our one-dimensional array has 10 elements. Okay. So first, I want to slice first 5 elements. Okay. So what I'm doing actually, I put the slice before slice anything. It means it start from the first element, and here I define his stop. Okay, so he will stop on 5. Include or not include 5 elements?
Not include.
Yeah, you're right. Because the first 5 elements are actually from indices 0 to 4. Yeah. So then, okay. So now so it's our subarray. Okay? We can assign it to a new variable, of course. And here, we actually want to choose the last 5 elements. So we are doing it by defining from 5 to the end. Okay. And this way we will choose an array of the last 5 elements. Okay? Is it clear? Okay. Yeah. I'm only asking, is it clear or not?
It is. Otherwise,
it is. Okay, very good. So again, it's only introduction, yeah? Mm-hmm. But we should be aligned. Great. So now we choose the element, we want actually to choose element from some middle subarray, okay? So here, in this example, we actually choose the elements from, yeah, I got it, got the answer. So from 4 to 7 elements, so it have 3 values, yeah, because it's 4, 5, and 6, and the 7 is not included, yeah, as we talked, as we mentioned before, okay? So in this, okay, great. So here, actually, I want what it means, okay, guys? What do you think will be done here?
All the even.
Yeah. So, so it's actually array of elements by step 2. Yeah, because the third element, the third value is defined as the step. Yeah. So we actually give him the stop and the start and the stop as zero as. We did not define, so it's actually from the start, of the array till the end of the array. But our step size is 2, so he chose actually the even elements. Yeah, it's actually the even elements of our array. Is this clear? Great. Now let's look on this example. This example, we actually defined the start, yeah? We didn't define the stop, so it's until the end. And it's actually, and the step is 2. So in the first example, it was even elements of our original array. So in this example, it will be?
The odd.
The odd. Yeah, sure. So here we choose the others, elements of our original array. Great, we are progressing. Now, we are almost NumPy masters. Okay, so here, so a potentially confusing case is when the stop value is negative. In this case, the default for start and stop are swapped, and this becomes a convenient way to reverse an array. Okay? So here, actually, we have this array contains the old elements in reverse order. Okay? Because our step is actually negative. Have original size but reversed place. Here, okay? So if our original array was from 0 to 10 to 8 to 9, excuse me, and now we have to from 9 to 10. Okay? Great. So some other example. If we want our reverse array, here we have reversed every index, every other from index 5. So what do we have here? Which elements will be in array? And then here. So the elements will be in array are 5, 3, and 2. Because we have, reverse order, and actually it's all these values, yeah? Because we started from 5. And about it? It's okay? Yeah.
In the reverse order, when you design that the last element is 5, it is running till the index, till the fourth index, and this example in reduced order?
Yeah, this example. This example
is includes.
This example is a bit, yeah, but the first element it includes. The last element, no, that doesn't matter. So the first element is included in our, it's included in our subarray, and the last not, okay? So here the first will be 5, yeah? And then we will actually, his take is 2, so he will actually running on odds values from 5. So now we actually have multi-dimensional subarrays. Let's a little bit speed up. Okay. So here we have this example. That actually, we have our X2, two-dimensional, and the array. And in this case, we have actually slicing in two indices. Yeah. So two rows, three columns. Okay. In this example, we are actually do the slicing in the first axis. We have slicing from start to 3, and in the second in the second one, we actually take all the numbers, and the step is 2. Okay. Some manipulation. So, final example how subarray dimension can even be reversed together. Okay. So, in this example, actually we have the similar size, but reversed in two axes. Okay. It can be applied for n dimensional. Okay. Great. Very good. Now. Now we want to access array rows and columns. So here we want to print first column of X2. Okay? And in the case of row access, the empty slice can be omitted for a more compact syntax. Okay? So we can do it like this way. At printing 0 in place 0, x2 in place 0, it's equivalent to x2, 0, and here the all elements, okay? This is the first one, this is the second. Great. Okay. So, subarray is no copy views. Okay. As one of the important and extremely useful thing to know about array slices is their return views rather than copies of the array data. Okay, so this is one area in which NumPy array slicing differs from Python list slicing. Okay, in list slice will be copies. Consider our two-dimensional array from before. Okay. Now we do the example. So here we have print x2. Okay, it's our 2x2 subarray. Okay, and this is here our x2 sub. They are printed. Okay. Now if we modify this subarray, okay, we will see that the original array is changed. Okay, so actually manipulation on subarray influence on the original array. Okay, is unlike you if you familiar with Python or with a list container. So there, if you slicing your original list, yeah, you get other copy in memory. Here you have the pointer on the original one. Right. So here we did manipulation on its two sub, okay, in place 0, 0. It's 99, so now we will actually in the original one got 99 in the same place, okay? Okay, so we want the example was to show, so actually we have some problem. So now how we can create copies of array? So we do it with method copy, okay? So now we have a method copy. In this case, actually, we know that we want a copy of our array to be independent. So our subarray will be independent of our array, and we don't want to change the original array. Okay? So in this case, we actually do the copy. In this case, and here, we actually create a new x2 subcopy without index it without pointing to the original array. So and the example will be of course to show you in this that now we have manipulated on subarray but not changing the array. Okay guys? Is it clear?
Understood.
Very. So, okay, one of the important and the useful methods of NumPy is reshaping of array, okay? So, the most flexible way of doing this is will be reshape. For example, if you want to put the numbers 1 through 9 as 3x3 grid, okay, some matrices. You can do it the following. We actually define grid. Okay, we define here grid. And here, we actually define, here we define our NPR range from 1 to 10. And we're shaping 3x3. Okay, so now we actually can reshape our the arrays from one shape to other as we wish. Okay?
The shape also returns the result by value, not by reference?
By value, yeah. Okay. No, but actually the shape is you're doing manipulation or you're manipulated or your original one, yeah? If you're making a shape on grid, it's actually your original. Okay? If you're doing your shape on subcopy, you need to first to create it by using method copy. Yeah.
So why the lama sita grid shove in the mishaneta?
Mishtane. Can. Yes. You ask and ask. It's very good questions. Self reply questions. Okay, great. So another common reshaping pattern is conversion of one-dimensional array into two-dimensional array or Karman matrix. This can be done with reshape method or more easily done by making use of new axis keyword with a slice of grid. So let's see example with both of them. So of course we create our NP array. Ready? Row vector via reshape. Okay, so this here we have our array. Okay. Yeah, I'm actually shaping in the original way. Yeah, we are shaping as a vector by axis 1 is the 1 and axis 2 is 3. One row and three columns. Great, so now we want to do row vector via new axis. So we actually declare a x and p new axis. Okay, and this way we actually have the same operation like reshaping. And if you want to reshape, if you want to reshape actually the first, first axis, so we're doing like three one by one. So it's actually a vector of columns, yeah, rows. So we have only vector row. So here, sorry, column vector, and here we actually do it by NP graphs, okay? Okay, so the last thing that I will show you about NumPy arrays is actually concatenation and splitting. Then we will deep, and then we will deep into Python. So concatenation of arrays or join combination or join of two arrays in NumPy is primarily accomplished using routines np dot concatenated or np v stack and np h stack or np concatenate. Okay, so first we'll take a tuples of or list of arrays as its first argument, as we can see here. Okay, so the here we actually define x and y as two arrays, and here we want to concatenate x and y. So what we will get, the answer, our final assignment will be the values from. Okay, so we will have the, it actually will be the long array from one that we will compose from 1, 2, 3, 3 to 1, yeah. Okay, great. Now we can concatenate more than two arrays at once. Okay, so concatenate actually the third array. So we have Z. Okay, so now we concatenate X, Y, and Z. Okay, and this way we can continue operation, concatenate more. Okay, so read. Okay, so it can also use for two-dimensional arrays. Okay, so great, and now we'll concatenate read and read, and here. Concatenate along the second axis. So we want to concatenate grid and grid by axis 1. Okay? So that's what we do this way. And for working with arrays of mixed dimension, it can be clear to use NP V stack, okay, vertical stack, and NP horizon stack. Okay? So this function gives us the ability to work with the arrays from with not same dimensions, okay? Mixed dimensions. Okay, so let's see this example. This is the first one. It's V stack, vertical stack, and it's actually a horizontal stack. So in the end, how we're doing splitting. So the first one we use NP split, okay? So here we want to split, we have x1, okay, we have x1, x, and we want to split it by x1, x2, x3, okay? So we do the NP split x3 by 5, okay? And the answer will be we actually split the first three values to x1 and the x2 will get the 99, and the last one will be 3 to 1. Okay? Okay, very good. So now we actually do it combined, so it's the arrange and reshaping. Okay. And here we can actually, this is the example of using MP H-split and B-split. So here we actually define upper and lower one. Okay, so we use the MP B-split on grid. It's two, okay? So we got this. And we need to use horizontal split, so we have this one. Okay. Great, we finished it. Now we are continuing to very good. So PyTorch. So it was introduction to NumPy. There are a lot of other very useful functions, but I'm pretty sure that you will find them by searching in Google. So now, actually, we have to cover some. We know about NumPy. We are going to start to introduce our introduction to PyTorch. Okay. So first, we present our first neural network, which learn to map training examples. Okay, so we will actually have some data set, and we will have the input array and our output is output arrays. Okay, so first, how we import torch. So here we actually have import our torch. Okay, and ask what his version. So as you see in my computer, I have installed the last stable version is 0.3.1. Okay, so now we need to do some useful imports. So we import numpy as p, we import matplot .pyplot as plt, and torch autograph import y. Okay, so we will now explain what is variable in a few seconds. Okay, and okay, so our data preparation, get data function prepares the tensors arrays. A few words about tensors later, containing inputs and output data. Okay, second, we will actually create learnable parameters as get weights, function providers with tensor containing random values, which will be optimized to solve our problem, okay? And network model, it will be some simple network, produce the output for the input applying a linear rule, multiple weights with input data, and add the bias terms. So it actually will be Y, W, X plus bias. So what it actually describes this function? What do you see? What does this function describe? It's very simple. It's very useful machine learning algorithm.
Linear classifier.
Linear regression. Yes, it's actually linear regression. Very simple machine learning approximation. Okay, great. So we will then we will define our loss function. Okay, so loss function actually gives us information about how good model is. Okay, as loss is we want that our loss will be zero, yeah, or approximately zero. So our optimized function help us adjusting random weights created initially to help the model calculate target value more accurately. Okay, it's actually our step size. Okay, so let's start to define our variable. So First training data, okay? So we want to define function get data, okay? So as you can see, we define our train x and train y as NP arrays, okay? So NP arrays, they are important because they use us for pre-processing our data from the images of our data to our network. Okay, so today we actually will talk only about pre-processing our data, and in our next tutorial we will talk about the neural network itself and how we declare the neural network. So today we need to understand how we feed our data into the neural network. Okay, so first we define NP arrays, train x, train y, okay? then we will define D type as torch float tensor. So torch float tensor will have a similarity to NP arrays. It's actually a variable that we use to feed forwarding our data through the neural network, okay? So into the training, when we are doing training, our data is flowing through our network, our layers, okay? And we will define what is layer later, okay? Our some black box, and when we are actually into our black box, we are using tensor, float tensor containers, okay? But we need to convert our arrays from the preprocessing to network. So we define here D type as torch float tensor. Okay? So let's see what it does here. Okay, very good. Okay. Then, okay. You prefer to be this. Okay, so now we define x and y variables. So actually, x is our data that's feeding in our network, in our neural network, okay? As variable torch from NumPy train x, that type, D type, that requires underscore grad false dot view 17 by 1. Okay, very. Now we'll explain this line actually. So, what I want to create, my x as a vector 17 by 1. Okay, it's actually a column vector. Okay, so its vector must be one that I do on him computation on my during my training. Okay, so I actually take my train x and convert it from NumPy to tensor. Okay, I'm doing this in this line here. Okay, here we have actually in the underline we have here our tensor. Okay, and here I'm converting to tensor float tensor type. Okay, so now it's actually tensor that have precision floating point 32. Okay, great. So now I actually define that its tensor, okay, have not required gradients. So it means I will not going to a gradient through this variable, okay? And I want him to be viewed as one dimensional vector, okay? So I have float tensor, I have actually like array 17 by 1 that we can compute him, we can feed him into my network. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Great, great, great. Very important declaration. So the second one is will be why. So what do you think it's wise? Why it's out? Yeah? So our my output will be variable torque from now. Why? And eventually and we do the same way. So get data actually have sorry. Why is actually my labels? Okay? Why it will be my
What is the default view of it?
The because default only, view?
Yeah, because it's not there.
Yeah, yeah. The default view will be here as the view of the shaping of my array.
Okay.
Okay. So it will be like flat. Yeah. Right? Is it clear? Okay. So now, when I have. When I know how to feed my vectors, so x is my it's my actual data, and y is my results of equation, yeah. Because we want to solve the linear regression problem, so we have equation y is results mapping x to their original y's. Okay, we have equation now. We have the we have the solutions, and now we want to learn the system to predict this solution. Yeah, we want that in given x, we want to predict y. Is it clear? Great. Now we will define how we'll define loss function and drain and the trainable parameters. But okay, so it will take a few 10 minutes. Okay. Okay, here we have actually our we define our plot variable. Okay, so in plot variable we actually now we this way we could actually show our plot. Okay, why we define plot variable? Because the plot can be shown only on numpy arrays. Okay, so if I want to show my x and y's and their tensors, I need first to convert them to NDRs. Okay, okay. It's actually definition of it's only we define here function. Okay, here we actually define simple neural network. Y bread is actually torch dot matmul x. Y plus V, okay, it's actually the definition of linear regression, and this is actually our loss function. Okay, loss function minimize Y pred to be to Y, okay, and this is actually our optimization. So it's actually gradient descent, okay. So the W data is learning rate multiply W grad data, okay? Minus, okay? It's learning rate minus the W data minus learning rate multiply W grad data, and we do it on the weights and on our biases, okay? It's actually our optimization, or this way we do the optimization on our neural network parameters, okay? Very good. Here you can actually see our plot. Okay, so here we have our plot. So our hyperline is actually the predicted hyperline of our neuron. Okay. And this is our red points is actually our real values of our x.
Can you please return to the definition of the optimization function?
Yes, sure.
Yes.
And we will finish it now. I will tell, and we will continue next week. Yeah. W data is actually the value of tensor, okay? Because okay, W is defined like as a tensor, okay? So if you want to see his data, his value, you have methods like that data. So double the data give us our parameter, data our weight parameter, and we actually update in each iteration. W data minus learning rate multiply W gradient. Yeah.
Can you explain this line with the where the loss function is the four prime?
Can you please can you please close the door, guys? Yeah. The loss function? Mm-hmm. No. Okay, so here, okay, so our loss is actually MSE loss, okay? Or L2 loss. So we define it, okay? It's norm, yeah?
From the four param, the four param.
Ah, here, okay. It's actually, okay, so here we have our loss function as W red minus Y, okay? If we are iterating over our parameters in tuple WB, weight and biases, and if param grade is false, okay, so is none, it's actually not defined, okay, it could be, it's a function that we can to derivative it, okay, to get to derivative it. So in this case, actually, it's zero. We define it as zero. Okay. Not differential function. We define it as here as zero. His gradient. Okay.
So why is it not?
Okay. We finished for today. We continue next time.